You know, 2,000 years ago, he walked on these very steps you're sitting on into the temple right here behind you. Think about the Son of God walking up these steps. The Huldah gates are right here. Huldah was the prophetess. Remember Huldah in the Bible? Yeah. These gates are called, if you see the word, the arches or the three arches, these are called the Huldah gates because she would stand and prophesy. As people would come into the temple, she'd be prophesying. These are the teaching steps that Jesus himself taught on. The crowds would stand here and talk, would stand here and hear him talk. You're sitting on them. The Son of God is going to walk these steps again. I have news for you. He's about to walk on your steps that lead to your house. He's about to walk through your gate and your door. Lift your hands and tell him he is welcome. Say, Jesus, you're welcome. You're welcome to come to my house. You're welcome to visit my home. A woman one day had a phone call. It was Jesus on the phone. And he said, I'm coming to your house today at 3 o'clock. Make ready. So she got all busy and cleaned house. Everything got fixed up. About 12:30, there was a knock on the door. So she opened the door. There was a little kid out there. He said, ma'am, I've had nothing to eat all day. Can you spare some food? Oh, she said, go away, go away. I'm busy, I'm busy. Jesus is coming at 3 o'clock. I don't have time for you. She went back to the house and did whatever. Another 45 minutes or so passed, and another knock on the door. It was a woman, destitute, had a baby in her arms. Oh, she said, ma'am, would you mind helping us? I've had no place to live. My little baby needs food. Anyway, you can just allow us in, take us in for a few hours. Oh, she said, go away, go away. Jesus is coming at 3 o'clock. I'm busy. It wasn't a while. It's a little while later, and another knock came. Now there stood out a very poor man, old man out there. Old man, he said, I'm in need of some clothing. Can you help me? Oh, she said, I'm so busy. Come back later. Jesus is coming at 3 o'clock. Well, 3 o'clock came, and she's all ready now. Everything is ready for Jesus. 3 o'clock hit right on the dot. No knock on the door, but the phone rings. Picks up the phone. Hello, this is Jesus. Oh, Lord, I thought you were coming at 3. I came 3 times and you threw me out. Make sure you recognize him when he shows up. Make sure you recognize him. He may not show up the way you think he will. Are you listening to us? I have a friend of mine named Don Riling. That's a true story. Don Riling ministers right outside Rochester, New York. I used to go preach for him. Don was having dinner around Easter one day. He had a little church right outside Rochester. He's having dinner with a group of pastors. He told me this with tears in his eyes. And an old man walked into the restaurant. And the waitress threw him out. This old man just walked in. Didn't look too nice. and the waitress threw the old man out of the restaurant. So Don got up and said, "Ma'am, why would you throw this man out?" "Oh," she said, "it's nothing but a bum." He said, "Would you please let him back in if I pay for his dinner?" "Oh, of course, why not?" she said. So Don goes outside the restaurant, and there's the old man still out there. He says, "Please come back. Come into the restaurant. I'll pay for your dinner." And the man very quietly accepts his hospitality and comes in and goes and sits at his table by himself. The waitress comes and she brings the food and puts it in front of this old man. And Don goes back and sits with his friends, these pastors. Don looked at me, said, "Benny," and he's just crying real, real hard. He said, "I looked and suddenly the old man was gone." He said, "I got up and I went to the waitress. I said, 'Ma'am, why would you throw him out? I just paid for his meal.'" The waitress said, "I didn't throw him out." "Well, where is he?" "I don't know." So he starts looking for him. He looked everywhere for the old man, could not find him. All the pastors that were sitting at the table got up looking for the old man. Nobody could find him. His dinner, untouched. Don said his fork was untouched. The knife, untouched. The meal, not even the water. The glass still full. The meal, untouched. But the old man is gone. And Don is troubled. So why would the old man leave? In the middle of the night, Don is in his bedroom, in bed. His wife is sleeping next to him. When suddenly he felt the presence of a body in his bedroom. Somebody was there. You know how you feel when somebody walks into your room? And he felt somebody's in the room. He opened his eyes and there's the old man. And the old man said, "I was hungry and you fed me," and disappeared into thin air. That was on a Saturday. The next morning, revival hit that church. Now you talk about Jesus. He may not come in all his glory. He may come as an old man. He may come as a poor man. Just make sure to let him in. Lift your hands and say, "Give me eyes to see, Lord. Give me a heart that will discern your presence in person." Amen. So we talk about our families getting saved. We talk about Jesus coming in. Precious people, when the Lord walks in, they'll be saved. And I believe the Lord is waiting for something to happen, something for you to do. Right after that experience, one of the most painful things happened in Don Riding's life that brought salvation to a whole lot of other people. I'd go preach for him. Oh, I used to go every month at least. He had the cutest little kids, all blondes, like your kids. His little boy was so adorable. He had the blondiest hair I ever seen on a little boy. Like blonde, like gold blonde. Blue eyes. The cutest little face. One day, his little boy was coming home from school when a school bus hit the little boy and killed him. Right outside their house. His mom, the little boy's mom, Don's wife, Jane is her name. Jane comes running out and saw her little boy dead in the middle of the street, blood everywhere. She's in shock. By now, she's sitting on the grass in total shock. Don comes home. They went and got him from his office. He came home. His little boy is still there. The kids on the bus were out of the bus. The bus driver, who was a woman, was in total shock because she was the one who actually killed the little precious boy. She wasn't paying attention as she was driving the bus. And Don shows up. Now, let me tell you something, brother. That's a man of God. He gets on his knees. The whole neighborhood is out by now. He picks up his boy, blood everywhere. Picks up the boy like that. Jesus, he says, thank you for giving me this gift. You gave him to me and now you're taking him away. Thank you for his life and thank you for this gift. He starts praising God. He starts thanking God. All the neighbors that day got saved. They saw a man who could thank God in pain like that. You know, ladies and gentlemen, salvation comes in ways at times we're not expecting how it's going to come. The death of a boy brings salvation to a whole street of people, whole neighborhood. We don't understand God's ways. We do not understand that. All we know is, if you are a real Christian, no matter what comes your way, you'll take it with peace. The peace of God will fill your heart. And the people of God said, hallelujah. So now the jailer says in Acts 16:31, he said, what must I do to be saved earlier? Paul is in jail. And the jailer says in verse 30, sir, what must I do to be saved? And now the reply comes, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house. I'm believing tonight with you that your family will be born again. The God we serve is a covenant-keeping God. The God we serve is the God who keeps covenant. And salvation is a covenant that extends not only to us as individuals, but including the family. The covenant includes the family. If one partakes, all the family comes under that grace and can be saved. Because in Exodus 12:3, it says, a lamb for a house. A lamb for a house. Say that. If a lamb is for a house, then the covenant extends to the family.